They outnumber us by 200 million to one, and they are likely to outsurvive us. Their ranks are legion, a numberless horde on a nameless mission. In all of the animal kingdom, there are no more savage or successful predators, no more skillful hunters. Creatures of infinite variety and marvelous design, they are the true rulers of this earth, the monarchs of the crawling kingdom. A day begins, and with the dawn, a world awakens. The great green Amazon basin, a hothouse of creation, the living, breathing heartland of the crawling kingdom. In this steamy brew, all of life is steeped and simmered, bathed in life-supporting rain and bejeweled with dew. This verdant paradise is home to creatures barely known, and thousands more that wait to be discovered. It is the nursery for more than half the life on Earth. But peril haunts this earthly Eden, for here, nature has contrived a billion cunning variations on the theme of predator and prey. The deadly, the deceptive, thrive here in abundance. And those who venture unaware through this world of wonders do so at great risk. For survival in the crawling kingdom is a privilege granted to the cautious and the quick. By their numbers alone, the ants are the most successful animals on the planet. Some 10,000 trillion of them inhabit the earth, tireless runners pursuing their urgent errands. Among their ranks are tradesmen and thieves, craftsmen and carpenters, and industrious farmers. But it is their social nature that sets the ants apart. They are among the most communal of all living creatures, and they live and work in colonies that may number 20 million strong. No other living things have achieved such a rigorous division of labor, and their elaborate caste system, in the eyes of some, is a model of order, an example for humans to follow. Rivaling the swarms of locusts which lay waste to great swaths of grassland and forest, the leafcutter ants consume more vegetation in the tropics than any other group of animals. They are herbivores without equal. Go to the ant, O sluggard, it is written in the book of Proverbs. Consider her ways and be wise. For without any chief, officer, or ruler, she prepares her food in summer and gathers her sustenance in harvest. Driven by complex chemical codes, the hordes of worker ants cart away to their hidden gardens, the bounty of the treetops. Each bundle neatly sized and trimmed for easy transport. The moving mass behaves as one entity, with a million mouths, a million marching legs, and a single, unswerving purpose: to survive, to perpetuate the species. The nests of the leafcutters may cover more than an acre, great subterranean chambers secluded deep beneath the forest floor. In these hidden grottos, where sunlight never penetrates, the tribe tends a giant compost heap, contributing the harvest from the forest to a growing mound of mulch. Here, in total darkness, the tiny farmers cultivate a special fungus which thrives upon the mulch. It is this fungus which supplies the sole food of the tribe and the lifeblood of its offspring. For a time, the newborn will feed in these fungus gardens before taking their place as hard-working adults in the perilous world above. Though some feed on plants, many ants are confirmed flesh eaters, creatures for whom predation is a way of life. The giant hunting ant, at 1 inch in length, the monster of the ant world. But it has made the mistake of invading the domain of a clan of tree-dwelling Azteca ants, fierce warriors 1/10 its size. With painful bites and a foul-smelling spray excreted by special glands, the warriors disable the giant, rendering it defenseless. The wounds are not fatal, but the repellent of the Aztecas carries a sober warning. In the world of the ants, trespass on your neighbors at your risk. It is a warning often foolishly ignored. For rapacity, few animals on Earth are the equal of the ants. Ounce for ounce, they are among the world's most ferocious predators. But none evoke more terror than the infamous army ants. Their appetite for plunder is legend, their tactics grimly efficient. Of all the wonders of the Amazon, there are few sights more awesome than this. A company of army ants on the move. Across living bridges built from the bodies of the workers, the armored legions swarm, their mission undeterred by any obstacle, their columns unopposed by any foe. More than a million blind warriors form the vanguard of the force, following their noses to their prey. Like the Mongols and the Huns in human history, they are a band of nomads set upon a course of conquest. And when, at night, the horde stops to rest, 100,000 bodies form a living tent. Linked together in a chain, a mass of worker ants protects the multitude within, with the legs of each worker grasped in the jaws of another. Snug inside the tent, the wingless queen reposes with her brood and retinue of royal attendants. They will rest here through the hours of darkness. Then, with the dawn, the ragged army marches on, and no living creature, large or small, is safe from their attack. It is said in local legend that an army of these ants can dismember a hog in an hour, a horse in half a day. The usual prey, grubs and other insects, is processed in minutes. With their great hooked jaws, the soldier ants are born for the business of butchery. And with professional skill, they tackle the task of carving the prey into manageable pieces for transport back to the camp. Ruthless though the ants may seem, they have enemies of their own. In nature's scheme of checks and balances, even the dreaded army ants may meet their match in the Aztecas. Here, chemical warfare is pitted against the power of conventional armaments. On the battlefields where insect armies clash, evolution's bold experiments are tested, and new techniques for hunting and defense are polished and perfected. It is neither admirable nor evil. It is simply life. But if the legions of the ants possess a fearsome reputation, there is another clan whose reputation is more chilling, the master craftsmen of predation. Their webs are things of wonder, delicate, alluring, and deadly. The ancient Greeks believed they were the work of a gifted maiden, doomed to weave forever, snaring the unwary in her gossamer webs, webs spun of air, webs festooned with diamonds and pearls. To the tribes of the Andes, the webs were a magic staircase upon which the souls of the dead were lifted from the lower world of the earth to the lofty realm of the heavens. Wherever we look in this world, the traces of webs bear evidence of builders at work, the architects of giant funnels, scaffolds, and ladders, the creators of lace-like tapestries, of glittering golden orbs. Never far from her work, the mistress of the web patiently waits. She is a legendary temptress whose cunning is matched by her artistry. Her kind is everywhere upon the earth, coveting the crannies where the light is dim, the shadows deep and dark. There are more than 40,000 species of spiders, all of them killers, who dispatch their prey with doses of powerful poison. A golden Nephila has found a katydid in her web. She delivers the killing bite, and the potent enzymes in her saliva begin their work, converting the soft parts of her prey into a soup-like pulp. Committed carnivores, the spiders and their kin kill only living prey, and for this task, they are admirably equipped. Their sense of touch is acute, and most boast four pairs of eyes, useful tools for a hunter. They are the wolves and the panthers, the vipers, the sharks, the master predators of the micro world. The aptly named wolf spider is a skulker of the forest floor, relying on its sharp eyesight to pursue, capture, and kill its insect prey. Like many spiders, the wolf spider shuns a web, preferring to lurk in the litter of pine needles and leaves until a potential victim happens its way. The green lynx spider has a similar ploy, waiting in the blossoms of flowers to ambush its prey. But it is the orb weavers that have won the spiders their reputation as artful hunters. A disturbance in the web triggers a response. In the blink of an eye, a luckless grasshopper is stunned and swathed in a funeral shroud of silk. With her victim neatly wrapped and stowed away, the spider can retire. But she will return to feast upon her trophy at her leisure. By a woodland pond, a tiny grass spider falls prey to a jumping spider, a more powerful and agile predator. It is a drama endlessly repeated, for a single acre of grassland may hide 2 million spiders. The grass spider herself is a formidable hunter, setting her sticky snares for midges and other small airborne travelers. fastidiously, she drinks the liquid tissues of her prey. Then she moves on to kill again. Like a giant sieve, the web filters the tiny flyers from the air, holding them captive until the owner of the web is ready to feed. To help her find her prey, the Nephila relies on the tufts of hair which adorn her legs, hairs which are sensitive to vibrations in the air and in her web. Her keen tactile sense is crucial to the Nephila's survival, as it is to all of the web builders. But in the micro world, where the webless spiders seek their prey, visual powers are equally important. These are jumping spiders, the male on the right, the female on the left. Stimulated by the female's pheromones, the male performs an elaborate mating dance, seeking through his display to seduce his would-be mate. She coyly waits. If his performance does not meet with her approval, he could become her meal. His attentions are acknowledged. She submits to his advances. The blueprint for a future generation is written in the mixing of the male and female's genes. Product of some 300 million years of evolution, a spider the size of a dinner plate stalks the earth today, the one they call Araño Peluda, the bird-eating spider. A true giant of the spider world, Araño is a close kin of the tarantula, and one of the most primitive of all living spiders. Like the tarantula, it builds no web, preferring instead to stalk its prey. Through its fangs, the spider delivers a deadly dose of a powerful neurotoxin, a poison strong enough to swiftly kill a small forest mammal or a nesting bird. While the enzymes the spider has injected go to work digesting the tissues of its prey, the hunter withdraws. But it will soon return to feed. Seeking fresh frontiers to colonize, the giant spiders long ago adapted to a land of bone-dry winds and scorching sun. To some it may seem a sinister place, a fitting place for the great hairy-legged hunter, the desert tarantula. A grasshopper, careless enough to come within reach, is suitable prey. Its struggles are soon over. the predator retires to dine at leisure in its den. But in nature, for nearly everything that kills, there is a more formidable killer. The tarantula hawk, a ground-dwelling wasp, the nemesis of the desert tarantula. The wasp has appropriated the spider's nest, but its feverish labors have a still grimmer purpose. The tiny wasp counts the giant spider among its prey. Numbed by the wasp's powerful sting, the tarantula makes an easy victim. It is maneuvered onto its back, exposing the tender abdomen. It is here that the wasp administers the coup de grace, a paralyzing sting. Rendered defenseless, the spider is dragged back to its den, which will become its tomb. In the shadows within, the wasp will lay a single egg, and the grub that hatches from that egg will consume its host alive. The leafy woodlands of America are home to one of the most dreaded of all the members of the crawling kingdom. Here she strings her messy web, the damsel with the hourglass on her belly, the notorious Black Widow spider. Only the female of the species is dangerous, but she packs one of the most virulent animal poisons known to man, a toxin 15 times more potent than rattlesnake venom. Though barely a millionth of an inch in diameter, each strand of the widow's web has the tensile strength of steel and a coating of glue to snare the unwary. Her legs detect a trembling in the web. A house cricket has stumbled into her trap. The strands of the web hold tight, rendering escape impossible. With her delicate legs, the widow pummels her prey, maneuvering it into position for the fatal bite. Injected at last with a lethal dose of nerve poison, the unlucky guest will go the way of the rest, hung up on a line to be sucked dry, a protein-rich meal to be savored when the time has come to feed. Though she is renowned as a huntress, one quality sets the widow apart from all the rest: her role as a femme fatale. Smaller by far than his consort, the male black widow heeds an urge that it cannot resist, the urge to procreate, regardless of the risk. He tweaks the web to signal his intentions. She signals her acceptance. He approaches with caution, then sets to work fulfilling his obligation. The union is done. The chores of the male are complete, and he is free to go on his way, or at least, so it would seem. Like the rest of her prey, he is packed up and stored away to make a meal for another day. But his sacrifice will not be in vain. Soon after, in the shadows, hidden from light, a miracle occurs. From the egg sac, tended by the widow, comes a bumper crop of baby spiders, each infant driven by the solemn mission to populate the world with black widows. It is a mission doomed to fail, for few of the spiderlings will reach adulthood despite the care of their doting parent. As the black widow is famed for its mating habits, the diving spider is renowned for its choice of habitats. Equipped with her own scuba tank of air, Argyroneta, the diving spider, tends her brood in a realm that no other spider has colonized, beneath the glassy surface of a tranquil woodland pond. It is an unconventional choice of a home for an air-breathing animal like a spider. Like all spiders, the diver breathes through a vent in its abdomen. But it obtains the air from a diving bell, which it constructs of silk below the water's surface. By refilling its portable scuba tank from the diving bell, the diver is free to conduct all of its business underwater. It is, however, a life fraught with hazards. For if, through a mishap or an encounter with a rival, the portable bubble should break, the diver may drown. During frequent forays to the surface, the diver picks up fresh bubbles of air to transport back to the bell. The task of maintaining the life support system is time-consuming and never-ending, but it is essential to the spider's survival. Fine hairs on the spider's abdomen trap the air and hold it to its body as it moves between the surface and the bottom of the pond. Like underwater astronauts, the divers are commuters between realms, dancing delicately between disaster and survival. curiously, the divers have retained the habit of spinning webs. Festooned with tiny bubbles of air, they beckon and beguile, sprawling across the pond like the lights of some alien city seen from space. But it is not for beauty that the spider lives. Like all predators, its purpose in life is to prey. A damselfly nymph, fresh and succulent, tempts a huntress. She delivers the killing bite. Then, drowned and dragged away, the victim is cached until the hunter needs to feed. The surface of the pond is a nursery for aquatic insects, and to a diver, the plump young nymphs are a resource for the taking. Like all spiders, the diver possesses an uncanny sense of touch, and the slightest vibration on the surface is sufficient to send it scuttling after its prey. Few predators find prey so plentiful, or life so filled with peril. In the aftermath of plunder, the huntress enjoys the rewards of her labors, feasting within her diving bell on the meal that she has won. Mysterious and marvelous, the spiders are among the most accomplished predators on Earth. They are architects and killers, creatures we regard with wonder and with horror. For millions of years, they and their kin have woven their magic spell, adding beauty to the world and contributing, in their quiet way, to nature's grand design. Though birds may be the most visible creatures in the tropical forest, they are far from the most abundant. That distinction belongs to the insects. As many as 10 million species of insects may share this world with us, comprising almost 3/4 of all of the animal species on Earth. By a wide margin, they are the most plentiful life form on the planet. And at every instant around the world, untold trillions of their kind are busily at work. It was 300 million years ago when the first flying insects established a beachhead on the land. And since that time, they have colonized nearly every terrestrial habitat, multiplying and dividing until today, along with their kin, the spiders, they claim dominion on the ground and in the air. In the sheer variety of their shapes and their skills, they are without equals. And like these spiny pus moth caterpillars pupating en masse on a rainforest tree, they are incredibly prolific. With their fellow members of the phylum Arthropoda, the insects are consummate professionals, superbly specialized for the business of survival. Though found in nearly every corner of the globe, they are most at home right here in the tangled maze of the Amazon forest, host to a true menagerie of tiny monsters. Among them, the hister beetle, an habitué of slimy places, of dung, and of decay. Other specialists include click beetles and wood borers, hunters of the hidden world beneath the bark of trees. But none among the crawling clan is odder than the dragon-headed bug, a kind of fly designed to fool the eye, persuading a would-be predator that it is not a bug at all, but a deadly lizard. Disguise is vital here, for under every leaf and rock, savage hunters prowl. The whip scorpion, Mastigoproctus. Its special skill? Disabling other predators with a numbing spray of pure acetic acid. Silently, methodically, it stalks its prey. It is a drama that has been replayed for 100 million years. A grasshopper waits a moment too long to make its escape. It dies in the jaws of the predator. Armored for protection, a female elephant beetle stoops to drink from a forest pool. The reigning heavyweight of her class, she ambles off in search of rotting fruit, while a male of her species, equipped with horns for combat with others of his kind, patrols the tiny patch of forest which he claims is his domain. Like all insects, the elephant beetle wears his skeleton on his back, a crusty cloak of hardened cuticle which guards him from the elements and shields him from attack. But he is not alone. With thousands of potential rivals in a single patch of forest, competition for resources is keen. The Hercules beetle, a behemoth by insect standards. Measuring more than 5 inches in length, it is the Tyrannosaurus rex of its kind. But danger plagues each step it takes, to a creature of its bulk, an accidental upset could prove fatal. And for every arsenal honed and hardened on the field of combat, nature has devised another, deadlier, more fit for battle, for survival. Titanus gigantea, one of the heftiest beetles in the world. With its sensitive antennae and its enormous multi-lensed eyes, it scans its world for news of danger or opportunity. The giant beetles are the elephants and rhinos of their realm, and when two rivals meet in a contest over turf, the micro world is witness to a battle of the titans. Though the combatants in these jousts rarely suffer fatal wounds, it is the aim of each to flip its foe onto its back. For a beetle, its most vulnerable position. Death is inevitable for a contestant unable to right itself. Though a beetle may hoist an object 100 times its own weight, regaining its footing, once lost, can be a Herculean task. The survivor's reward? A small patch of this earth on which it may feed and procreate. But one victory counts for little among the untold millions of tiny tragedies and triumphs which unfold in the course of every insect day. And so the dance goes on, the dance that weaves through all creation. Driven by an ancient urge, new multitudes amass to mark the dawning of another day, a day like billions that have gone before it in the crawling kingdom.